Olympic bob run on Mount Van Hovenberg is about the last word in technical perfection, both of construction and maintenance. It costs over $250,000 to build and equip.
We're in no hurry.
Attention! Go!
Attention! Stand off!
What's that?
The Italian team, the Lanfranchi brothers.
All right.
Have them face us while you're talking.
Look here.
All right, Tom.
This is Captain Weinstein Gell and his brakesman, Count Gudenus of the Austrian Olympic team.
All right.
Hugo, wir haben viel Chance, was, bei der Meisterschaft und bei den Olympischen Spielen heuer.
Ja, weißt du, mir gefällt die Bahn sehr gut. Und ich hoffe, dass wir gut abschneiden werden. Wir werden unser Bestes tun.
Na, hoffentlich. Doi, doi, doi.
Servus.
I've been out here in Maluji and come into
Look over here, though, when you talk. All right, now. Mm-hmm.
Introducing Count Rossi and his brakesman, Captain Cassini of the Italian Olympic team.
Yeah. Hi, Count.
Here we have Lieutenant Papana, the driver of the Romanian team, and his brakeman, Captain Hubert.
Fragst du sie, dass unser Schlitten rankommt? Sie, dass unser Schlitten rankommt?
Ja.
What? Ready?
Well, how's the luck?
No, Tom.
This is Captain Killian and his brakeman, Mr. Hoover, of the German Olympic team.
Wir hoffen, dass wir weiterhin gut abschneiden. Unser Training war sehr gut, die Bahn ist in sehr gutem Zustande und wir werden unser Bestes tun, Deutschland bei den Olympischen Spielen würdig zu vertreten. Wenn wir Glück haben, werden wir vielleicht wie im letzten Jahr es siegen.
Meet the Lanfranchi brothers of the Italian Olympic team.
I think this run is beautifully built, and I hope I'll get some good runs down, the same as any other.
Just hold it. Will you say that on the...
Oh. Yep.
Get on.
Hoover. German team, Captain Killian driving.
All right, let her go.
You're up.
Good luck.
German team, Captain Killian.
Are we next?
Captain Killian. Yeah.
This is left to right, driver Christian Hanses and brakeman Max Hooven of the Belgian two-man bob team.
La piste n'est pas très facile, c'est la seconde fois que nous descendons. Mais seulement nous espérons, avec un peu de practice, d'arriver à un bon résultat, bien que nous n'avons que quelques jours pour nous entraîner. Nous espérons tout de même avoir un résultat honorable pour notre pays. Tout pas?
Ben, écoute, moi je crois que ça sera bien difficile, on s'en fera de son mieux.
Qu'est-ce que vous avez?
Nothing. We want, I mean, we're making a picture here. This is the Italian four-man Olympic bob team. That is Agostino Lanfranchi. That's Gaetano Lanfranchi, and that's Captain Cassini.
This is our steer, Conte Rossi.
You bobbies!
You bob wop!
This empty two-man bob is being sent down the 1.5-mile Von Hovenberg run in order to prove that the dangerous curves and turns are correctly constructed. There are four pieces of lead weighing approximately 200 pounds on the bob.
All right, let her go.
Approaching white face, taking the curve, riding high, through.
This bobsled is one of a fleet of 40 used on the Mount Van Hovenberg bob run in Lake Placid, New York. It combines the best features of European bobs plus tricks that American workmen have found in building wood sleighs. It has runners flat on the sides and rounded on the bottom so that it will cling to the icy surfaces of the run. It is equipped with two sets of brakes. Foot brake operated by the pilot and a hand brake operated by a man sitting in number four position. The sleds are of two types of construction, the four-man and the...
Approaching cliffside. Taking a curve. They're through cliffside.
American team number one has broken the two-man bobsled record.
Just had a very wonderful trip down the slide. However, it's the thrill of the sport rather than the victory that really counts in bobsledding.
Attention! They're off!
Harden on the line!
There we go.
Attention!
Bill Fisk, the pilot, our steersman. Eddie Egan, number two. Tippy Gray, number three.
Better not forget J. O'Brien, the captain, and the brake, too.
I hope you like it.
Is that all right?
I'm very, very glad, my dear Fisk, that just you, the old fellow from St. Moritz, won my cup. I'm very glad to give this to you.
Thank you. I'm very glad to have been able to win this cup for America, and I hope it stays in this country.
And now, as these scenes of ice and snow fade into the distance, we draw the curtain on this greatest winter sports spectacle ever staged on the North American continent. The third Olympic Winter Games of 1932. Spectators from the four corners of the earth and contestants from 17 nations, to all of whom Lake Placid has played host, prepare to return home. The spectators realizing as never before the universal appeal of King Winter's sports of snow and ice. The contestants intent on still greater records for their homelands in the Olympic competitions 4 years hence. Goodbye and a snowy winter to you all.
From what we have seen of the Bob run here at Garmisch, I believe it to be one of the best in the world. This, no doubt, will be one of the greatest races ever held.
Expecting to get some good practice at Garmisch. The runs are different, but this one bids fair to be a very good one. Probably the most exciting curve is the Bayern curve, which is immediately following the Labyrinth and the Killian looping. It is a difficult curve to take correctly, and if any spills are to be had, it will be at the foot of this curve.
Team has its day of glory in the two-man Bob. The Italians make it 1-2 in the spine-tingling event. Fifth and sixth spots went to the American sleds, piloted by Bud Washburn and Art Tyler. Trying to avoid a spill, brakeman Ed Seymour twisted his knee. Another Olympic casualty. The Italian sled, skippered by Lamberto Della Costa, roars around the final turn and into the stretch, wrapping things up with a second sizzling heat. A popular victory for sure in the snowball village of Cortina. roundup of thrills in the Winter Olympics at Cortina and Tempezzo. Here are the four men Bobs hurtling down the treacherous mountain run. Four men. Freaks. The women's giant slalom get. Dan Benham and Pat Martin of the U.S. team get away. And then it's a head-snapping start for the favored German two-man bob, piloted by Andreas Osler. On a sleet-coated hillside just outside Oslo, pilot and brakeman risk their necks on the newly built bobsled run. Benham and Martin are second, as Osler wins his country's first Olympic gold medal since 1936. Contrary to custom, the formal opening of the Winter Games takes place a day late at Bislett Stadium in Oslo. Over 1,100 athletes from 30 nations are competing in the Winter Classic, the biggest ever. A crowd of 30,000 is in the big stadium as the American team, largest contingent in this snow and ice spectacle, parades on the ice. A perilous footing for a parade.
That is the goal at which we aim in sport as in life.
Thus the commentator in the official film of the 1948 Winter Olympics. Because of the war, no one had ridden the Cresta for 8 years, and so no one knew quite what to expect. For Britain, John Crammond was strongly tipped. In the event, Britain could only manage the bronze once more. Amazingly, the silver medalist from 20 years before, the American Jack Heaton, was competing again. And again, came second. A 19-year-old Italian, Nino Bibbia, in only his second season, took the gold. It was the start of a remarkable career that was to last well into the 80s. It was Lord Brabazon in those lean post-war years who saved the Cresta from melting away like the snow in spring. Cabinet minister under Churchill, holder of the first private pilot's license in Britain, and all-round sportsman, he kept the Cresta going by sheer determination. In a rare interview, Hugh Thomas asked Brabazon when he first rode the Cresta.
I think I started on my honeymoon when I in 1907, when I was 23.
This is about 50-odd years, then.
Too many.
Why do men go down the Cresta, do you think?
Well, that's very difficult to answer, but you see a toboggan, you see the run, you say to yourself, very naturally, why can't I go down as fast as anybody else?
How old were you when you last went down the Cresta?
from Pezzo in Italy. ABC's Wide World of Sports is here to cover the World Championship in bobsleds. Now, this is a two-part competition. Last Sunday, the two-man bobsleds were concluded, and at a later date on Wide World, you'll see that competition. Today, a tragedy occurred in the four-man sled, and because of it, we're not going to be showing you the competition as we normally do. The driver of the American sled, Jim Morgan, of Saranac Lake, New York, was fatally injured in a crash on his first run today. By a terrible quirk, really, his brother, John Morgan, has been working with us for the last 10 days as our expert on bobsleds. In fact, John was very apprehensive about the run today, simply because it's unusually warm here in Cortina, and the track was getting very slick, and by the luck of the draw, the United States sled was the last one to run. This was just moments before the start. Jim Morgan here, the driver, saying words of encouragement to his team members.
Hey, give me the hand here.
And before the run, the Italian television cameras showed the drapes that had been put up to help shield the curves from the warm sun. In fact, as the camera panned over, you'll see how slick it was in that high corner. The Americans were ready. Jim Morgan, the driver, calling the commands to set. They rock, and then they start the count.
One, two, three, go!
Morgan, the driver, the first in the sled, followed by Jeff Yost, Paul White, and Randy Bielski. Pretty good start, 5:49, considering the more difficult footing. This pushing off has been an area the Americans have been a little bit weak in, but they've been working hard to get a smooth, coordinated start. Just a slight hesitation there, getting in by Paul White. Otherwise, very, very good. And then, this was the way that John Morgan and I called the rest of the American run. In order for this United States sled to move into ninth place ahead of Great Britain, they're going to have a clocking of 1:14.38. Let's watch the intermediate time.
He looked good so far. He had a very good start. Not bad in the labyrinth for Jimmy. Let's look for the intermediate, Bill.
45:77. That's slower than the British time, but Jimmy is not one to hold back on the lower end of the course.
Yeah, again, his nickname is Nitro, so I don't think he's going to hold back at all. He's got the last sled down in this heat, Bill, and the track conditions aren't to his advantage, but let's see what he